want to welcome you all to this general meeting of the League of Women Voters. I'm Kathy Fitzgerald. I'm on the board of the League of Women Voters of Utah. We are here to talk today about the climate. And I want to start by reading the League's positions on climate. Both the League of Women Voters of Utah and the League of Women Voters of the U.S. have positions and have long held positions on climate and environment. The League of Women Voters of the United States says that it has been in the forefront of the environmental protection movement for decades, consistently supporting legislation to preserve our nation's natural resources and protect our public health. We support legislation that seeks to protect our country from the physical, economic, and public health effects of climate change, while also providing pathways to economic prosperity. Furthermore, climate change is the greatest environmental challenge of our generation. The League works to build grassroots support for action on climate change nationally and at the state and local levels in order to avoid irrevocable damage to our planet. The League of Women Voters of Utah declares their fundamental intent to promote an environment beneficial to life through the protection and wise management of natural resources in the public interest by recognizing the interrelationships of air quality, energy, land use, waste management, and water resources. The 2016-17 program calls for defending the environment, including climate. Promote a sustainable lifestyle to preserve a Utah environment beneficial to life, emphasizing climate change, air quality, energy issues, transportation, public land, and water and seismic issues. And promote League positions at the Utah legislature and other public arenas with emphasis on working in conjunction with other organizations, which is one of the things that we are doing today. I would like, before we get directly to our program for today, we have a couple of announcements to make. Soon Lin.
Thank you, Kathy. Mark, Tuesday, April 11th, 11 o'clock, it will be starting our State of the Community Luncheon. It is going to be a wonderful event. We are going to be celebrating the women of Utah in many ways throughout the luncheon. Our theme is Worth Their Salt. And we're going to be acknowledging many of the women in our community, not just now, but from the time Utah was founded. And so we would love to have you there. Our program will be excellent. It will be emphasizing women in Utah. And we'd love to have you join us and bring your friends. It's going to be a very good event. No, it's our 25th anniversary of the luncheon. It's our silver anniversary.
Okay, and we there's one more announcement I'd like to make. At the end of March, our unit meetings will be about redistricting in Utah. We want to get ahead of the ball on this issue. So we're going to start working on and talking about and making progress toward redistricting fairly in Utah in 2020. So, the end of March. The times and places of those meetings are on our website. If you go to the Utah Voter, you'll find dates and places. Okay, moving right along. I want to mention that there will be a question and answer period after our speakers. You each have a card in front of you. that you are welcome to use in, as you think of questions. Fill it out, hold it up as soon as you get it written down, and we have people who will come around and gather those questions from you. You don't have to wait till the end, just kind of hold it up and we'll pick it up. And if you want another card, we'll give you another card too. We will then, when all three speakers have finished, we will have a question and answer period. Okay. Okay, I would like to introduce our first, well, I will introduce all three speakers. We have Dr. Robert Davis, Dr. Ryan Stolwe, and Steve Glazer, who will be speaking to us today. Our featured speaker is Dr. Davies. And I will introduce, I'll give you each of their biographies as they get up to speak, because you forget them. So Dr. Davies is a physicist and educator whose work focuses on synthesizing a broad range of Earth system science through a lens of human sustainability. Over the past decade, Dr. Davies has developed and delivered hundreds of public lectures on climate change and human sustainability. He is an associate of the Utah Climate Center and an adjunct professor at in Utah State University's Department of Plants, Soils, and Climate. He has taught on the faculties of three universities, worked as a project scientist for Utah State University's Space Dynamics Laboratory, as a technical liaison for NASA's International Space Station project, and served as an officer and meteorologist in the United States Air Force. Dr. Davies.
Well, thank you so much, and Kathy, and the introduction, and Carol for the invitation, and for all of you for coming. I'm wondering if maybe we want to catch the lights, some of the visuals might be easier to. Perfect. Thank you. Well, as you just heard, I spent a little. As you just heard, I spent a little bit of time working on the space station project. It's kind of a fun thing to think about. This is a picture of the space station basically as it is today. This was someone I worked with quite a bit at the time. Her name is Tracy Caldwell. She's a PhD chemist and also a NASA astronaut. She's looking out of a piece of the space station called the cupola here. And I always imagined the... And this has happened, and it continues to happen. I always imagine what it's like when, at the beginning of each day, the astronauts have their meeting, and the very first thing on the agenda is the commander says, "So we've got a little bit of a problem with our life support system." And I'm pretty sure that everything else comes off the agenda until that is fixed. And of course, they're not alone. They're working at it with the ground controllers in Houston and in Moscow as well. But the space station provides kind of a nice metaphor, or you know, sort of microcosm for examining this picture. And so what has happened with us in our society today is that science is telling us with a very loud and clear voice that there is something wrong with our life support system. And we're not quite reacting in a way that I think a space station crew would react. And maybe this is a way for us to think of how maybe we should be reacting. The knowledge comes to us from an enormous broad spectrum of science that we have built up over many hundreds of years, of course. And physics, and of course, Ernest Rutherford, my favorite physicist, famously said in the early part of the 20th century, "In science, there is only physics. All else is stamp collecting." Of course, he won a Nobel Prize in chemistry. So I think that was the revenge of chemists. What I want to point out here is that this pyramid of science, sitting at the very tippy top of it, is this notion of climate science. Understanding Earth's climate system to the level that we do surely stands as one of humankind's great achievements, great intellectual achievements. All of you're not supposed to be able to read all those other things. Those are all sub-disciplines and sub-sub-disciplines, and I'm trying to simply dramatically make the point that it takes a tremendous amount of science synthesized over a broad spectrum of science to understand Earth's climate system as well as we do, which is not to say that we understand it perfectly. But we do understand quite a lot, and it's very important to know that not knowing everything is not the same as not knowing anything. And we do know quite a lot. And in fact, we could say that we are the very first generation to understand human disruption of climate, what we often just shorthand call climate change. That said, there's a tremendous amount of confusing and conflicting information in our society about this topic. So if this is how you feel, I simply like to point out that you have every right to feel that way. And so what we're going to try to cut through that. The reason that it's so confusing is because there are really two aspects to this. Try it every now and then. I'm going to try this one more time because it's... there are two aspects to this topic of climate change. There is the science of climate change, and then there is the public issue of climate change. Now, the science, of course, is the physical phenomenon itself, based on calculations, measurements, observations, etc., etc., and it's really about what we know about the climate system. On the other side of this is the public issue, which is really about what do we do. And, of course, all kinds of other things come into that, our identity, our politics, our values. It's about how we respond. And we're going to talk about both of these things in the next half hour or so. But I'm going to start with this notion of what do we know. And as I said, we know quite a lot. I'm going to summarize it in four things, sort of points to talk about. And the first one is simply that Earth is warming globally. This is what it looks like from the end of the 19th century to the middle of the 20th century to today. And as you see the different locations on the globe go from the cooler blues to the warmer reds, that is that location warming. The deeper the red, the more the warming. This is not absolute temperature, it's temperature change. So the Arctic up there did not get warmer than the equator, but it has warmed up more. Let's look at it one more time. End of the 19th century, middle of the 20th, to today. And this is data up to date over the last several weeks. We see, this is very rich data. It comes from many, many thousands of sensors over, as you see, more than a century. Two things are very clear from this. First, essentially the entire planet is warming up. Every point on that map got warmer than it was before. And the second is that the warming is not uniform. Some places are warming more than the others. And in fact, the high northern latitudes are warming at about twice the global average. Okay. If you average up all the locations on the planet as a whole, the Earth has warmed over the last century or so about 1.1 degrees Celsius, a little over 1 degree Celsius. For those of you who are metrically challenged, I understand. You can always convert a change in temperature from Celsius to Fahrenheit by essentially doubling it. Okay, so that's about 2 degrees Fahrenheit. Okay. Now, we can do that not just for this last couple of years, but we can do that for every year. We can say, well, how much has it changed, you know, how much had it changed by 1980, by 1990? And if you do that, you can plot the global average temperature for a given year starting at the end of the 19th century over here, going all the way to today over on the right, relative to some baseline. So we just want to know how much it's changed relative to something we have a feel for, and that feel is the middle of the 20th century. That's what we'll call zero. And you can see then that the Earth was much cooler in the earlier part of the 20th century and much warmer in the later 20th century with this continuous progression of record-setting years, the most recent being 2014, and then 2015, and then 2016, shattering that record again. Okay. So a very strong trend in global warming. This is what we mean by global warming, and this is what it looks like. Okay. The second thing we know with very high confidence is why we're warming. And not to put too fine a point on it, but it's because of us. Principally from our emissions of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, that principally comes from the burning of fossil fuels. There are other things involved, but to the sort of most important term in the equation, this is it. And this is what that rise in carbon dioxide in our atmosphere looks like over the last 40 years or so. If I were to take this back several hundred years, you'd find that the levels in the atmosphere have risen about 50%. Most of that rise has come in the last 50 years that I've displayed here. We're now sitting at about over 400 parts per million. That's 400 carbon dioxide molecules in the atmosphere for every billion other molecules. And we started off at about 280 parts per million a few hundred years ago, sort of before we started burning fossil fuels in earnest in the Industrial Revolution. Now, this is important because carbon dioxide is a greenhouse gas. And greenhouse gases, because of their molecular structures, are able to take energy that was leaving the Earth in the form of light, specifically infrared light, and capture that energy and turn it into thermal energy in the atmosphere, and so heat the near surface of the planet, the atmosphere, the land, the oceans. That's what greenhouse gases do. We understand the physics of greenhouse gases extremely well. In fact, the physical equation that tells me that a molecule of carbon dioxide will absorb a certain color of light and turn it into heat is the exact same physical equation that allows us to build something like this. It's called the Schrodinger equation. It describes how matter, atoms interact with light. And so this is physics we understand very well, and this is why we're warming. The third thing we know with very high confidence is that this warming of the global of the globe is disrupting the climate system. And that's because everything is connected to everything else. So for example, we all know that warmer air holds more moisture. And so as you warm the atmosphere, evaporation intensifies, and areas that are dry tend to get drier. At the same time, though, now you've got more moisture in the atmosphere, and when you get a storm, there's more of it to come down. And so precipitation events tend to be more intense as well. We call this an intensification of the hydrologic cycle, intensified evaporation and intensified precipitation. And if this were the only impact of warming the atmosphere, it would be significant, enormously significant. We're already seeing impacts of this all around the globe for the warmings we've already experienced. But as I said, everything is connected. So it's not just an intensification of the hydrologic cycle. Everything changes. We change the cryosphere. This is the ice sheets, glaciers, frozen tundra. We change where storms form and how intense they are. So we change where it precipitates, where it rains, where it snows, where it doesn't. How often, how frequent, how intense. We change whole internal climate cycles to the globe, such things as the El Niño-La Niña cycle. We change where things live and where they can't. We change where things grow and where they can't. We change soil moisture. We change ocean chemistry. We change everything. And this is what we mean by then climate change. So anthropogenic global warming, human-driven global warming, is driving a disruption to the climate system. Of course, the disruption to the physical climate system propagates its way into the living systems on the planet, the biosphere. It's driving where things live. We're seeing, on a global scale, migrations away from the equator toward the poles and upward in elevation, and a substantially elevated extinction rate, partly as a result, and increasingly as a result, of our changing climate. And then, of course, the changes to the physical climate system and to the biosphere propagate their way into what I call the anthroposphere, human systems, our human world. Because, of course, we are entirely embedded within the biosphere and within the climate system. And so changes are being observed in human systems as well. Energy, health, political systems. There are now 66 million people on the move on the planet, forced displacement, refugees. Many of them come from places where climate change has been an additional stressor to the conditions in which they're living. Syria is one example. Preceding the Syrian civil war were 4 years of very intense drought, which was intensified demonstrably by a warming climate. There are people in North Africa who are being displaced, can no longer grow their food because of change of the climate there. And these are, of course, propagating their way into our human systems and our political systems, usually politically destabilized in some places, as we're already seeing. So the climate is changing, and it is affecting us already with the level of change that we've seen. Here in Utah, we are warming. No matter where you look around the state, what I've shown you are those graphs, our temperature graphs. The blue lines show you the trend over the last 40 years in those different locations. As a whole, Utah is warming at about twice the global average. There are places in southeastern Utah that are warming at about three times the global average. And that change is having impacts to us here locally as well. We're seeing a significant shift in extreme high temperatures. We're seeing things like declining spring snowpack, which is important, of course, because most Utahns get most of their water from snowpack. Changes to the ecosystem here, for example, bark beetle infestations, which are combining with the drier world to bring on hotter and bigger wildfires. We are seeing all of these things and more. I'd like to just give you a quick example of extreme high temperatures here in Utah. And Tooele happens to have a particularly nice, very complete long-term temperature record, so that's why I'm going to throw up Tooele here, but we see similar trends all around the state. What I'm showing you here are summertime high temperatures in the 1960s. What you're seeing is how many days did I have a particular temperature? And so a few days in the summertime, these are the three summer months, where the high temperature was only in the 60s, a few days where it was in the upper 90s, mostly the sort of the most common high average temperature in Tooele in the 1960s was right here at 91 degrees. And you see no days above 100 degrees. This is what that same distribution of temperatures looks like in the first decade of this century, so 2000 through 2009. And you can see that the whole distribution has moved to the higher end of the temperature line. So clearly the average temperature has gone up a few degrees in Tooele. Since the 1960s. And where you see the light blue, that's where there were just more cooler days in the 60s. Where you see the darker red, that's where there were more warmer days in the 2000s. But I want to focus in here on this high temperature tail when we talk about the extreme temperatures. So this is the days above 90 degrees in Tooele in all the decades of the 20th century, the 1910s, 20s, 30s, 40s. Here's where human-driven climate change kicks in earnest. This is where the human tug on the climate system has become bigger than all the natural tugs. And you see this continuous progression of more and more days above 90 degrees in Tooele as we move from the 1960s forward to today. But it gets even more interesting as we go to higher temperatures, days above 95 degrees, days above 100 degrees. So in the entire 20th century, there were 66 days above 100 degrees in Tooele. In the first decade of this century, there were 94 such days. So it's not just a change in average temperature, but a change in the extreme temperatures, and often it's these that have the biggest impact on the living systems and on the human systems, and then we can go forward to 103 degrees, four days above 103 in the 20th century, 28 days above 103 in the first decade of this century. In Park City, for example, fewer days below 32 degrees in Park City. In 1970, they had 219 days below 32 degrees. In 2015, 175. That's 6 weeks fewer days that it can snow in Park City in the last 40 years. Okay, so the Earth is warming. It's because of us. It's driving a disruption in the climate system. We know these things with very high confidence. The fourth thing we know with high confidence is that this carries with it extreme risks for humans. Now, as when we talk about risks, we need to talk about what's going to happen in the future. So to do that, scientists try to model the climate system and gain information about what can we expect for climatic conditions as we move forward. And I want to say just a couple of words about this term model. So these are not the models that are helping scientists better understand the climate system. In this case, when I say model, I simply mean physics. And I don't mean climate physics. I just mean physics. This is the exact same physics that allows us to build microwave ovens and spacecraft and take pictures of our planet from the edge of the solar system. But apply to the climate system. Okay? So this physics has a lot of street cred, you might say. And by applying it to the climate system, we're able to understand, get some sense of what might happen. We can make projections. So here's that global temperature record that I showed you earlier. I plotted it a little bit differently, but you can see the rise in temperature from over the last 100 years. What I'm going to do is just kind of squeeze it down, smooth it out for averages for the last 40 or 50 years there, and then give me some room for some projections moving forward. Our baseline is 1990, by which time we had already warmed about 6/10 of a degree Celsius on this particular projection. And then here's the range of temperature projections moving forward to the end of this century. So for the next, over the next 83 years or so, to the year 2100. And you can see that there's really quite a range of projections from perhaps an additional 1 degree Celsius of warming on the low end of the projection, all the way to an additional 5 degrees warming on the high end of the projection by the end of this century. And the different shadings are the uncertainties. There's uncertainty here. You might say, well, that's quite a spread. Doesn't sound like the models are very good. But the models are run under different scenarios. How do we humans choose to move forward? The uncertainty here is there's a little bit of uncertainty because of natural variability. What, you know, some years are a little warmer than others. That's natural. It has to do with the way the Earth redistributes the energy within it. There's a little bit more uncertainty because we don't understand the physics and how to apply it to the climate system perfectly. But most of that uncertainty is based on human behavior. How do we humans choose to move forward from today? And in particular, how much carbon do we intend to dump into the atmosphere? And what you find then is under the lower carbon emission scenarios, you have lower additional, although quite significant, temperature rise of an additional 1 to 2 degrees Celsius. And under the high carbon scenarios, which are the scenarios we're currently tracking on, we get an additional, say, 3 to 4.5 or 5 degrees by the end of the century. So that's the source of that spread of uncertainty. What do we humans choose to do? I view this as really good news. The good news is most of the change in front of us is still up to us. That's what the physics tells us. I want to give you a kind of another quick cartoon here to put this in context. This is a thermometer, graduated in Fahrenheit. You're welcome. 45 degrees Fahrenheit on the left, the global average temperature at the depth of the last ice age, call it 15 or 20,000 years ago. 75 degrees Fahrenheit on the right is the warmest we think the planet's ever been, about 55 million years ago. Now humans, modern humans come on the scene, the anthropologists tell us, about 200,000 years ago. So this temperature, global average temperature, has nothing to do with human. And of course, modern human civilization comes on the scene maybe 8 or 10,000 years ago. So the green oval is the human climate. This is where we humans have always existed. And more importantly, perhaps, the human ecosystem. The area between the two lines there is where human civilization has always existed. And the purple oval is where we're headed this century. That spread of temperatures I showed you on the other graph. And you'll note, this is all to scale, and there's no part of the purple oval that overlaps the green oval. In other words, we are moving to a completely new climate. And so when you hear the scientific community become more and more concerned about what is happening, it's because of this. We are moving to a climate to which we are biologically and societally not at all adapted. And we're doing so very, very quickly. I want to point out, too, I forgot to, that last graph, on the high carbon, but in the low carbon scenarios, by the end of the century, the temperature was leveling off. But in the high carbon scenario, by the end of the century, it wasn't leveling off. We hadn't stopped warming. We just cut off the simulation then. The warming continues beyond that. So as extreme, and it is extreme, as another 5 degrees Celsius of warming would be, that's not where it stops under a high carbon scenario. Okay. So this is our choice. And it is a choice. Let's take a look at temperature projections over North America real quick and compare and just get a sense of this choice a little better. Under a low carbon scenario, we see over most of the US, including Utah, an additional 4 degrees Fahrenheit of warming over the next century. Under a high carbon scenario, an additional up to 13 degrees Fahrenheit of warming. And that number, can't remember if I have it on here, this is about 25 degrees Fahrenheit of warming in the Arctic. Spring snowpack, of course, very important to us here in Utah. I'm going to show you some observations of the spring snowpack starting in the middle of the 20th century, and then look at some projections of how that evolves under a high carbon scenario. That's the scenario we're currently tracking on. So you're going to look at this area right here. This is spring snowpack, April. The blues are deeper snow. The whites are thinner snowpack. And we're going to start with some observations in 1950. And you'll see that some years the snowpack is thicker than others. There's some variability to it. We all know that. Snowier years than others. As we move into the 2020s now, we're looking at projections. So we're warming the atmosphere. We're changing precipitation patterns. Getting more of our precipitation as rain. By the time we get to the middle of the century, we've had a significant decline. By the time we move to the latter half of the century, no spring time snowpack. This is not also, I should say, rocket science. I don't mean to diminish the skill and effort required to do this kind of modeling, but it's not too hard to understand. As we warm, more of our precipitation falls as rain rather than snow. One more projection I want to show you of obvious importance to our society is soil moisture. Of course, which our vegetation and agriculture heavily depends. I'm going to show you two projections. Under a moderate emission scenario, so we start to decline our carbon emissions, but not radically. This is how we see soil moisture evolving over North America. As areas get browner, they're getting drier. As they get bluer, they're getting wetter. Starting today, moving to the middle of the century, you see significant drying over most of the lower 48, and then continued drying throughout the rest of the century, particularly in Central America. We get wetter in Alaska and Newfoundland. Now let's look at a high emission scenario. Again, the scenario we're on. Again, significant drying through the middle of the century and then dramatically intensifying through the end of the century. Now, I haven't really given you the information to interpret the colors. I'll simply tell you that the people who look at these kinds of projections, the agronomists, biologists, ecologists, agricultural economists, etc., refer to the moderate emission scenario as dangerous, and the high emission scenario, our current path, is catastrophic. And they use that term catastrophic fairly technically, meaning unadaptable. Unadaptable. So that's the sort of that's the scale of risk that we're looking at. This is the best state of knowledge of our science. This isn't, you know, 6 teenagers in their parents' basement running computer models and eating Doritos. This is hundreds and hundreds of our most finely trained scientists around the world doing their very best to diligently understand what is happening and why. And this is what we understand going forward. Is there uncertainty? Absolutely. And which is now where we move into the discussion on climate change is a public issue. It's important. Often a lot gets made of this notion of uncertainty in the models. We can't trust the models. And nobody knows that better than the scientists who do this. But in the case of public policy and in the case of risk management, uncertainty is not your friend. The more uncertain you are about these levels of impact, the more conservative you want to be on your response. When the risks are extremely large, you kind of don't want to get anywhere near bringing them about. I could give you many, many dozens of quotes from the scientific community. I'm just going to give you two that are highly representative. This is Lonnie Thompson, a distinguished glaciologist, virtually all climatologists are now convinced global warming poses a clear and present danger to civilization. I go to many conferences, I speak to many, many scientists, I read lots of the literature. This is an accurate representation of the mood among the scientific community on this topic. Kevin Anderson, a distinguished carbon modeler in the United Kingdom, there's a widespread view that a 4 degrees Celsius future is incompatible with an organized global community. What he means by a 4 degree future is where we have warmed 4 degrees above the pre-industrial temperatures globally, average. We've already warmed 1.1. Okay, so an additional 3. Incompatible with an organized global civilization. Our civilization is highly adapted to the climate we have, where we produce food, where we get water, our shorelines. So this is the state of our knowledge. And so that brings up the notion of risk management, and back to the notion of what do we do? How do we respond? Does science have anything to say about that? And it absolutely does. It's a pretty simple formula. More carbon is more risk. A dangerous level of global warming was identified by scientists 20 years ago as 2 degrees Celsius global average. That's been since revised downward to 1.5 degrees Celsius. And that's because as we calibrate, as we look at what are the scale of impacts based on the amount of warming that we've already had, we're finding that the impacts are turning out to be bigger than we're anticipating. And so the recalibration as well, it turns out that we think that you get the catastrophic impacts or the dangerous impacts at 1.5 or so degrees warming as opposed to 2. And so this allows physics to calculate what you would call a carbon budget. How much more carbon can you dump into the atmosphere and maintain a reasonable chance of staying below 1.5 or 2 degrees? Now the calculation I'm going to show you is for 2 degrees. So there's our 2 degree carbon budget, which really means an additional 0.9 degrees. Remember, we already warmed 1. About 1,000 units of carbon dioxide more that we can dump into the atmosphere. Now, these calculations were done in 2010. Since then, we've dumped more carbon into the atmosphere, so we've chewed up some of that budget in the last 6 years. So there's our budget. Here's how fast we're going to chew through that budget on our current consumption patterns. Less than 2 decades. And here's that budget relative to our proven carbon reserves. This is coal and oil and natural gas that we know where it is and we know how to dig it up conventionally. So what the physics is telling us is our carbon budget is about 1/3 of the carbon, the coal, oil, and gas that we already know how to get. We've already found it. Now, this is if you don't count newer means of extraction like fracking and tar sands extraction, but we should count those reserves because we have been doing that. And if you count those reserves, then our budget is only about 1/8 of the reserves that we have identified and are currently exploiting. So to summarize the state of the science, at the moment, dangerous climate disruption is underway. At the moment, on our current trajectory, catastrophic climate change is probable. And we've got about a 2-decade window for meaningful response. But we have a window. Right. So it's at the end. Fortunately not. People have been thinking about how do we move away intensively from carbon in the next 2 decades, and I will simply briefly outline that for you to conclude. So the first is the notion of new exploration, new mining, new infrastructure for fossil fuels. I think it's very clear that we can't do these things and expect to meet our budget and stay below this 2 degrees Celsius danger line. I'm not trying to say that in any kind of a judgmental way. I'm simply saying that we can't do that if we want to engage in any kind of meaningful risk management on this topic. So we need a managed decline in our use of carbon, and we need a roadmap for that, and there is a roadmap for that. It involves changes in our demand, this is how we use energy, and it involves changes in our supply, this is how we produce it. Briefly, demand side simply means we need to reduce how much energy we use, and we need to do it deeply. Let me give you one example of how this works and how it can work. In order to get 10 units worth of useful electricity in your home, so 10 units worth of lighting a light bulb or running a computer or your television, it turns out that the energy system has to deliver 133 units into the grid. It's that inefficient. So for every 10 units of energy in our homes, in our businesses, in our factories, in our society, of electricity, excuse me, that we can reduce, we actually save 130 units. It's a huge multiplier. So in-home and business and locally used demand reductions can play a huge role in moving us in the direction that we need to move. The second thing that's important to recognize on this is that not everybody has to do this. In the world, 10% of the world's population is responsible for 50% of our emissions. 20% is responsible for 80% of our emissions. So what you'll often hear as an argument against these moving away from fossils is that, well, fossil fuels is how you deliver electricity to the world's poor and lift them out of poverty. It's not the world's poor that are causing this problem. They can continue to develop and use energy. We are the ones that need to cut back. It's not about population, it's about consumption. Okay. On the supply side, we know how to do this transition. We don't need new technology. We don't need new knowledge. We're going to get both, and that will help, but we don't need it. In the first 3 months of last year, 2016, in the United States, 1,300 megawatts of new electricity generation from renewables, mostly sun and solar and wind. Now, that's enough to power about 250,000 homes. During that same first quarter of last year, only 18 megawatts of new gas generation and a whopping zero of new coal and oil. So that tells us that we already know how to do what we need to do. This is already happening in the energy sector. I'll also point out that this is nowhere near the scale that we need. Currently, renewables comprise only a few percent of our energy mix. But in other words, we don't need new technology to do this. We have what we need. Around the world, last May, Portugal powered itself for 4 days straight 100% renewably. Germany regularly achieves a third of its power generation renewably, sometimes more than 90%. Great Britain is now running regularly without coal for days at a time through massive wind and solar. Now, Germany, by the way, is also massive wind and solar. The amount of solar in Germany is tremendous, and I don't know who here has ever been to Great Britain or Germany, but these are places where the sun really doesn't shine that much. And they're still able to make tremendous motion forward, not with new technology, with the technology we have. The difference between them and us is their social structure, how they're doing it as a citizenry from a standpoint of public policy. So to this, four things that we know with high confidence. I'll add one more, and that is we already have what we need to change course. That does not mean to diminish the scale of the task at all. I will simply say that this is not about research and development of new technology. This is technology we have and knowledge we have. What we don't have at the moment is sort of the societal know-how, the social technology, so to speak, to move us forward. I forgot to bring the actual quote, but this is Dennis Meadows, who's quite a big person in the field of human sustainability. When people throw up the economy as a notion, you know, we can't move away from carbon, it will be economically disastrous. That's one side of a cost-benefit analysis. The other side is well, that's what it costs. What does it benefit? And I think the notion is, well, what does it cost an economy to completely collapse? As we move towards more and more unadaptable changes, the environment is the source of all life and every economy. And we've got a great big warning coming at us from Houston saying something is wrong with the life support system at the moment. We're just not paying any attention, not in a meaningful way. So I know the next two speakers have something to say about how to actually meaningfully start getting involved. If you're not, and clearly the League of Women Voters is already meaningfully involved. And I think if there's a silver lining to the last few months, I apologize if I'm making assumptions about political inclinations. I mean this in all seriousness. It has been hugely energizing, I think, for many people. Under Barack Obama, we were moving in the right direction, but not very quickly. Under Hillary Clinton, that was probably going to continue, also at an insufficient level. Now I think the political situation has been enormously clarified for anyone who wants to move forward. And I have one more, let me come back to this slide. Speaking as a citizen, this is where I am. We need to be effective. I don't mean simply raging. I simply mean we need to be effective. But, you know, 6 months ago, Rex Tillerson for Secretary of State, who wants to drill the Arctic, who wants to forge relationships with Russian oil exploration, Scott Pruitt for the head of EPA, who does not believe in the EPA, Rick Perry for Secretary of Energy. 6 months ago, these would have been onion headlines. These are now reality. And I don't want to be a person who stands up in here and says, well, this is what we have to work with. We're going to move forward. Like, this is just something else. This is not normal. This is so far beyond normal, in my experience, that it requires a completely transformation of in our minds as to how we move forward. That's my personal belief. And I think it's based on the scale of the challenge, the scale of the risk that we're facing. Thanks for your attention.
We could turn the lights back up, I think, or do you have...
Yeah. I have a couple slides, but they're not as interesting.
All right, well, we don't have to. If you have questions, hold them up and gather if you like. Each of our responders will speak for approximately 10 minutes.
Kathy, we can't hear you.
Oh, of course not. Each of our responders, hold up your questions if you have questions. Each of our responders will speak for approximately 10 minutes, and then we will open up the forum for questions. Our next responder is Ryan Stolle. Dr. Stolle is the program manager of the Utah Climate Action Network and an adjunct professor at Westminster College. He earned a PhD in organic chemistry from the University of Utah in 2013 and previously worked for the U.S. Department of Energy. Ryan recently welcomed the League of Women Voters of Utah into the Utah Climate Action Network, a partnership between government, research institutions, nonprofits and foundations, faith-based organizations, the private sector, and individuals working to address climate change in Utah.
I want to thank Dr. Davies again. What he said is a very big component of how we're going to address climate change. And then to that end, there's been research that shows you can educate and you can educate and you can educate, but if somebody holds it in their core values that they don't believe it, all you're going to do is just reinforce them to hate it more. So let me tell you about the tack that we're taking with the Climate Action Network. Despite its somewhat aggressive name, we are a nonpartisan organization, as she mentioned, of government offices, research institutions. We even had some individuals and some private businesses. And what we're trying to do is just normalize the conversation, right? As you saw, a lot of those charts and the maps and the heat maps that Dr. Davies had shown, that's not a belief, right? I mean, that's actual facts of actual warming, right? So if somebody holds it as a belief, We have to slowly ease into their value system to say, look, this isn't about belief. This isn't about taking your money away. This is about addressing a serious issue. So let's just get to work, okay? So we had an initial convening group. It was spun out from Salt Lake City, the sustainability office, as well as University of Utah, ALTA, Salt Lake County Health Department, Utah Clean Energy, and Park City. And essentially, the vibe that they put out was, if we're not gonna get help to do this from the state, we're just gonna do it ourselves. What we're gonna do is we're going to reduce our emissions, and we're gonna lead by example by showing that we're not losing money doing this. We're supporting jobs, we're supporting local infrastructure, we're educating constituents, and we're also actually cleaning up the air, which we all know is a huge issue here. So here's our mission statement here: fostering diverse conversation, leadership, and coordinated action. So what we're trying to do is not be outward and vocal proponents and saying, we need climate change, we're not marching on the Capitol. What we're trying to do is to bring people into the fold to show that this is a normal thing to do, that we can make or save money by doing these types of programs, we can mitigate climate change, and we can normalize the conversation in the state. An interesting fact about the state here, we get 85% of our electricity from coal. Of that, 85% comes from the state of Utah. So you have to believe that that's a very serious issue that we're gonna have to deal with, particularly as coal is one of the highest greenhouse gas contributors, okay? So we have to show that we're not just gonna put everybody out of work, although there is only something like 1,900 coal jobs in the state, or if even that, and that includes transportation such as trains and shipping and trucks. And so, but we also have something like 26,000 solar jobs in the state. And so that shows you that if we try to suppress solar, what the current legislation is going through, we're actually gonna eliminate jobs, even though we're trying to save jobs by promoting coal, if that makes any sense. So what we're trying to do is just have collaborative response to show that we can do this and that we can actually mitigate some of this climate change. So we have our website here, where we will put all of our information that's coming down the pipeline. We have quarterly meetings where we bring everybody together to spell best practices and the projects that we're all working on individually. We're all focused on our impact drivers. So some of these are gonna be impacted more heavily than others, and some are gonna be contributors, right? So we have water. As Dr. Davey showed, we are gonna be a central drying location. As the temperature increases, the aridness of Utah is going to increase. If you look at the projections now, with the anticipated growth in the Salt Lake Valley, we already do not have enough water to support the next 30 years worth of growth. Now, what happens when we have less snowpack? That means we have less water. That means the economics of our local economy is going to suffer greatly. We're not gonna have enough people, we're not gonna be able to grow, we're not gonna be able to sustain even what we have here now. So one thing that we're doing right now is we're working with the Department of Homeland Security to do a climate threat analysis. So this says, if we have the water systems, whether they're drinking or wastewater within the state of Utah, what are the present threats that are to the wastewater system, and what will they be under different climate scenarios? So as Dr. Davey said, as it heats up, maybe we're gonna have massive precipitation. Maybe we don't normally get massive precipitation, so this can cause some severe flooding across the valley. This may cause contamination and backflow in the water systems. If we go to a high arid scenario, we're gonna have to then have to reroute, say for like Bear River Project and these other types of scenarios, how are we gonna mitigate this? So what we're doing is bringing together all the water managers across the Wasatch Front to begin with, and then moving into the greater state to do the threat assessment and put together policy plans to put towards the legislature. If you can show that this is a stakeholder driven, this is an issue that's brought up by the people who have to manage the water, you have a much better chance of pushing things through. Something else we're looking at is energy use. As I mentioned before, solar jobs in the state were booming. Over 2015 and 2016, we were the third state in growth in solar, and we're currently gonna squash that. So I used to work at the Department of Energy in the Solar Energy Technologies Office, and we saw this quite a bit in Utah. We were very happy to see that it was growing in the state, and so we wanna keep this pressure up. Transportation, we know, is a huge issue. So I know that the refineries get a lot of flack for contributing to the air here in the Salt Lake Valley, but actually about 30% of the contribution comes from driving and transportation across the valley. So if we can work towards sustainable transportation practices, whether through the city or the county or other municipalities, this would be a great way to mitigate some of our climate impacts as well as our air quality impacts. And I think particularly prescient is to draw the the overlaps between clean air and climate impacts, right? I mean, there's greenhouse gas comes off that also contributes to the particulate matter and the other ozone contributors and other types of regional pollutants that we have. And so if we can try to tie these together, I think we have a better chance of discussing climate change within the state. Public health is a huge issue. As you look at the warming temperatures you saw in Utah Lake a couple years ago with the algal bloom, as the decrease in water continues and the heat continues to increase, we're going to see more and more issues of contaminated water. We're going to see higher migration patterns for insects that we don't normally get here. So whether they're kissing bugs, if they spread chikungunya, or they're going to have different species of mosquitoes that don't normally live here that are also carriers of disease. Land use, this is a huge contributor to climate impact, whether it's through methane release from raising animals. If we're tilling our soil, we're releasing a lot of the carbon that's sequestered into the soil. And so what we're currently trying to do is investigate, actually hope we can talk about USU Extension School, to how we can address land users in the agricultural sectors of Utah. Something else that we're having down the line is we've been awarded a grant. We are the second path to positive community behind Los Angeles. Now what this is to have coalitions of leaders in five key sectors: local government, healthcare, public health, education, faith, and business. So we've already made inroads in this through the network. But what we want to do is provide these leaders with the rationale and resources, so information like Dr. Davies can provide to business leaders so that they can discuss it with other business leaders. You create this network of support and normalization, and hopefully you can actually just push the needle forward. We actually don't worry about the partisanship, and we can actually just start working on solutions. If everybody's pointing at each other and saying, you're doing it wrong, or because you believe in climate change, that means you believe in these other issues, nothing is ever gonna happen. So if we can just normalize the conversation, people can actually start working on bipartisan or even partisan solutions to these types of issues. Now, the first path to positive community was Los Angeles, and as you might imagine, it's people coming out of the woodwork to sign up for this. They put it out, they put out the signal flare, they had 600 signatories, they had a press release, they had, I don't know, I think like 1,000 people come out to their climate day, and as you might imagine, we're gonna do a different tack here. So what we're trying to do, we're going for moderate to left or to right-leaning business and local community leaders, trying to roll out slowly, and if everybody can kind of come out together, it's gonna be a lot easier for people to manage. So what we're trying to do and what we're trying to seek right now for the network is we're seeking for organizations to engage. Now, the organizations that we want are ones that have power to affect change. So that's why we have League of Women Voters, very strong advocacy groups. We have strong commitments to the environment and climate change. We're looking at the city. We're looking at the county. They have the financial and state power to enact some of these changes and actually push legislation through. So these are the types of organizations that we look for. We're looking for highly visible local leaders. So whether these are business leaders, religious leaders, or community government leaders who can actually bring people along with them to say that this isn't a partisan issue, this is a lifestyle issue, this is our life going to be destroyed, okay? And we want an engaged public to come out to our events, as we're only in our infancy, we're only a year old. And so as we start to develop, we're gonna start putting out public programs, we wanna have public events, and we wanna show that climate change matters to the constituency of Utah. And we wanna do this in a moderate and not overly advocate way. I think, like I said before, due to the fairly conservative nature of the state, sometimes advocacy and the more rampant or rabid counterculture that rides against it sometimes is not as effective as just trying to be quiet and subtle through it. So what we really want to do is just to normalize the climate conversations. And so that's what we're doing with the network. And once again, I'm happy to take any other questions. We have currently 27 member organizations, and we're looking to expand to 50 by the end of the year.
Thank you. Our question sorters are asking that you put just one question per card so that they can sort them more easily by topic. So if you would do that, and if you have more questions, hold them up and gather as we can get. Our final responder is Steve Glazer. Steve is an environmental chemist who evaluates toxic waste sites.
for a brief period in his 20s, he volunteered as a legislative aide in the Wisconsin State Assembly. It's my home state. His interest in policy, long dormant, has reemerged with his participation in the Citizens Climate Lobby for the past 3.5 years. He currently serves on the Salt Lake Citizens Climate Lobby Steering Committee. Steve.
Thank you, Kathy, and also thank you to both of our other speakers, which I found both of their talks really engaging. Hopefully this will measure up at some level. Okay. So, Citizens Climate Lobby, we have one agenda, which is to pass meaningful federal legislation to address climate change. And as an organization, we are nonpartisan, and we know that for this legislation to pass, to be effective, we need to appeal to conservatives as well as liberals. This is not going to pass, it's just a Democratic initiative. And so I'm going to give you a very brief introduction to this. We actually spoke at the various unit meetings of the League of Women Voters a year ago. And if you heard that, this will be a quick refresher. And if you weren't at one of those, this will be a quick introduction. So, our proposal is called Carbon Fee and Dividend. It is revenue neutral. It's very intentional that this is not intended as a program that would raise money for the federal government, because we don't think Republicans would buy into that. It's intended as something that's going to have minimal regulations. The idea is very simple. Put a price on carbon. It would start out as $15 for every ton of CO2 emitted for however much fossil fuel that is. So if you have this much coal and when you burn it, it generates a ton of CO2, that's $15. And it wouldn't stay at that price, it would go up by $10 a year. And so over time, that's going to become a very substantial fee. And to give you an idea of what that amounts to, $10 a ton corresponds to about 10 cents a gallon when it comes to gasoline. For utilities, if you're talking about electricity, it varies because every utility has a different mix of fuels. But if you look locally, $10 a ton corresponds to about 0.9 cents a kilowatt hour, which is about, on my last electric bill, about a 10% increase. As we said, it's going to be revenue neutral. This is not designed to be a large tax increase. And so after administrative costs, we are going to refund 100% of that money back to American families. So let's look in a little more detail how each of those components would work. So on the fee end of it, it's very simple. We're providing a price incentive. You know, before you were thinking, geez, I might insulate my home better, so I'll use less natural gas. But you say, no, there'll be a several-year payoff period before I get my money back in the form of lower gas bills. Well, if that period becomes a year or two, you're much more likely to go ahead with it. Even more importantly than that, I mean, we think of our emissions as being tied up. You know, we think about the gas we put into our car, we think about our utility bills. But about half of our emissions are tied up in the products we buy. Now, this computer took a great deal of energy to manufacture. And so, one of the things that this does is it makes the energy component much more prominent. And just as a simple example, let's say I'm a baker and I've got ovens from the 1950s. You're a baker and you've got modern efficient ovens. If our bread is comparable and I'm selling mine for $2.19 a loaf and you're selling yours for $1.99 a loaf, guess who wins? You will, and all of a sudden our bread is more energy efficient until, you know, the next person comes up with solar powered ovens or whatever, you know, solar powered electricity that's going to power their ovens. And part of that is that clean fuels, and I mean by that any fuel that does not emit CO2, that can be wind or solar or nuclear. becomes cheaper than fossil fuels within a decade, and actually that period is even less now when we did that study. That was before the recent drop in solar prices. As far as the dividend part of the equation goes, this dividend would come back monthly, first of all. And the idea is that after you subtract out the administrative costs, it'd be 100% return to households based on family size, not energy use. Some people say, you know, why is this going to, if I get a dividend, it's going to cover all of my energy expenses anyway. Where's my incentive to conserve? And an analogy I like to make is, you know, imagine you've got a child who's going off to college, and they say, geez, I need to raise money for books next year. I think it's going to cost $1,000. I'm going to get a summer job. I'll pay for those books. I'll pay for some other things. And yes, they get the summer job. They get the $1,000. And now they go off to college, and they find they can buy some of the books for half price. They're going to do it, and they're going to keep the money. And similarly, if you have money coming back into your pocket that you could use to pay for energy, but you know, energy, if you have a nice way to use less of it and use the money for something else, you'd probably prefer to do that. Another thing is that your check probably is going to be more or less than your what you pay in terms of this fee. And when I say, how much are you paying for the fee? Well, you're going to have higher utility costs, higher price of gasoline, and also the higher pass-through costs. So the higher costs of products because of the energy that is embedded in them. And it's fairly predictable, depending on how much money you make, as to whether you're going to get back more or less. If half of your products are tied up in the good, half of your energy use is tied up in the goods you buy, well, people that have more money buy more things. And people that have more money buy larger houses. It takes more gas to heat them. Their electric bills are higher with all the lights and the appliances and so forth. And so the people that make the least amount of money are paying the smallest amount in terms of a fee. And almost 90% of them will get more back than they pay into it. And that's very important. One of the objections to any carbon pricing scheme is that it's really going to hit on the poor. The dividend is the way to protect against that. And now another concern with a carbon pricing scheme is, what's it going to do to our manufacturing? Now, we're going to make our energy more expensive. And so that means if you're a local company and you want to export goods, it's harder to compete. Also, it's harder to compete because imports have a cost advantage. Well, we're going to take away that cost advantage. If you import goods from a country that doesn't have a price on CO2 emissions, we're going to put in a tariff on the goods, particularly at the beginning when we went into the energy intensive goods. But that fee, it's, you know, if you take something like aluminum, that's an example of one. We know how much energy it takes to make a ton of aluminum. And so if you're importing aluminum, whether directly or maybe it's part of a car, and it's from a country that doesn't have a price on their carbon emissions, we can say this is what the fee would be if that aluminum was manufactured in the U.S. So that is the fee from this imported aluminum. And so we'll create a level playing field. We hope it does more than that, actually. If you're talking about countries like China, where we import a huge amount of products from them, and that fee cumulatively would be billions of dollars, if not tens of billions of dollars. So if you're thinking in terms of this from the Chinese government, your companies are making the US Treasury much better off. Or you can put in your own price on CO2 emissions, and then you get to keep the money for your own treasury. There's a big incentive for other countries to follow in our footsteps, particularly our major trading partners. And so the last thing, of course, is, I shouldn't say the last thing, almost the last thing, is what kind of effectiveness this would have. We had a model of something,
of something that's almost exactly like what I've described here. There's some minor differences. And it showed over a 20-year period of time about a 50% reduction in CO2 emissions, which is huge. If you look in terms of what's needed, it's still not quite what's there, but it is a big part. It starts getting us down the road, and then we can look to augment from there. And then finally, the question is the challenge of the political part. And how do we get this through? Well, we are a nonpartisan organization. We have chapters, and we have over 300 chapters in the U.S. right now. Last year with Congress, we had over 1,000 meetings with Congress and their staffs. And we have had considerable success, more than you would expect, particularly with Republican offices. And this brings us to the next topic, which is the unit meetings within the league this next month. We're going to be, there'll be people from Citizens Climate Lobby participating in those meetings, talking about lobbying at the federal level. I know that with the league, you're quite comfortable lobbying at the state level, the local level. We don't have any experience with that. Our experience is all at the federal level. And we're going to talk about some of these experiences that we've had. A lot of it's going to be storytelling, a lot of it's going to be some how-tos and just comparing what your experience is with ours. I mean, with we don't claim to have a monopoly on the knowledge of lobbying, most definitely don't, but we have similar organizations. We're based off the volunteers, we're grassroots organizations, and as I said, with a lobbying focus. Some of these talks, we have, minor celebrities, so to speak, at least within, as far as we're going to get within the volunteer group lobbying. A couple of the unit meetings, we will have former congressional aides, and they'll be in a position to say, here's what it looks like from the other side of the table. We also have one of the meetings, one thing you may not know is that Nia Love has joined the Climate Solutions Caucus. That is an organization which is within the House has designed, hey, let's talk about the how we might move forward on climate change. What should our federal response be? And it's a bipartisan caucus. And right now there's 10 Republicans, 10 Democrats. And so the other thing that it does is it's, for the 10 Republicans, it's a signal to the other Republicans in the House that, you know, you can take a stand on climate change and not be voted out of office. You can still keep your office. This is not just a liberal left-wing issue. And so, you know, in terms of that, one of the people that will be speaking at one of the meetings, Tom Moyer, was a principal person in getting her to join that caucus. And that story will be told at all the meetings in some more depth. So that's just an example of one of the stories that we'll be telling and how we've got relationships that extend well beyond people that you might expect. Because Mia Love is not someone that I would have thought would have ever joined that caucus. So thank you.
Thank you. And I want to add my word about the unit meetings. Those of you who are league members, you know what unit meetings are. Unit meetings are local jargon for small group discussions. Our units meet at various locations around the valley. You can go online to the Riverbend Voters. Oh, we have handouts. You don't have to go online. Pick up a handout at one of the tables at the back telling when and where our unit meetings will be at the end of February. Okay, we do have some questions. The first question, is there a future for carbon capture? And could you explain what carbon capture is as you answer the questions?
And there's a microphone over there on your table.
What was the question? I'm sorry.
Question is there a future for carbon capture?
I can make a couple quick statements, and I imagine Brian and Steve may have something to say as well. So carbon capture and sequestration, often called CCS, means so you burn, let's say, coal, it produces carbon dioxide, but you capture the carbon dioxide, and of course you have to do something with it. There are a number of strategies for that. Often what you do is pressurize it, liquefy it, and pump it back underground. Some people already do this. They do it, ironically, to enhance the production of oil wells. So you inject it back into the chambers where the oils are coming from, and it adds additional pressure. There has been some limited success with that on trial scale basis. The problem is does the carbon dioxide leak out? So you need to inject it into geologic formations where basically the carbon dioxide mineralizes. And so it is a technology that's being developed. My major critique of this right now is, should we continue to develop this technology? Absolutely. But the problem is, it's not viable as a large-scale measure at the moment. And we just don't have a lot of time to play with. Since we have technologies and knowledge to move forward, I believe that we should design, follow roadmaps that don't require what I often call magic to work. And right now, carbon capture technology, in terms of a large-scale means of reducing carbon dioxide, is essentially magic. That doesn't mean it won't become viable at some point. But the problem is that often policymakers are relying on this, setting current goals, saying, oh, well, down the road, we'll have this, and that'll save us. Maybe that's true, and that would be great, but I don't think it's something we need to, we want to be relying on right now.
I have the exact same opinion. Something that's So carbon dioxide is a very special molecule in a lot of ways. So it is actually very hard to do chemical processes on. It's very inert in a lot of ways. And so, as Rob alluded to. One, it's low reactive, and so generating useful products is going to be very difficult, probably not very feasible, unless we're going to inject it into the earth. Plus, we're generating in such quantities that unless we can make something that we need that massive of a quantity of, so but that be plastics or fuels or something like that, which the technology is currently not able to address, then it's as Rob said, it's useless. It's a bit of a band-aid, and I think it's often used as a sales technique to perpetuate fossil fuels. I think it seems to be working.
Okay. Is it working now?
Yeah.
Okay.
I just...
Thank you. Next question. How does nuclear energy play into the climate/political question?
If any of you, I have a slide that might help with this.
Nuclear energy, it does not emit CO2, and so it is for the purposes of addressing climate change, it's extremely effective. There's other issues involved with it. I would say when I look at nuclear energy, I say the risks of nuclear energy are far less than those of burning fossil fuels. I would say that overall, though, I mean, you're going to be looking at a mix of wind, solar, and nuclear, and where you are, and I'm thinking globally as well, not just in the U.S., will determine what its role is, because it has different political connotations, different challenges in terms of getting things cited, and so forth, in some countries and others.
I think I can go through this fairly effectively. Steve, we should have a chat. But it's absolutely a discussion that needs to happen. My personal position, it's not just me, is it simply that while it is extremely low carbon, although we don't quite know how low carbon nuclear is because we don't know what to do with the waste. And the waste brings up other issues. You know, when the Department of Energy was developing Yucca Mountain, they had anthropologists on the staff. And the reason they had anthropologists was to figure out how to communicate to a civilization 30,000 years from now. Human civilization is 8,000 years old. how to communicate to a civilization 38,000 years from now to stay away from this place. Now, there are other nuclear technologies that have much lower lifetimes, et cetera. Those are not currently viable. It's, again, this sort of magical thinking that this will save us some time in the future. Let me quickly go through this. Nuclear power has low life cycle carbon. Nuclear power provides currently about 2.5% of global energy consumption. 2.5%, that's currently with nuclear. Supplied from 435 reactors. Currently in the region of 70 new nuclear power stations are being constructed around the globe. If nuclear were to ramp up supply to meet 25% of the energy we currently use, so it would be 10 times more nuclear, then approximately 2,900 power stations would need to be constructed and fully operational in the 2035 to 2040 timeframe. That is, we would need to complete and commission over 100 new nuclear stations a year starting today. So not only are there additional environmental challenges with big ones, with nuclear, it's also quite a challenge, just sort of from a deployment standpoint, to deploy this scale of nuclear power moving forward. And I would simply argue that, to me, it makes more sense. If you don't need it, why go there? And we don't need it. We know how to do this without nuclear. And there are road maps that do it without nuclear. It's not. I'm not saying it's easy, and perhaps there are areas in which it plays a role. But you can see that it's not often the magic solution that it's often portrayed as. But we have this and how to use it. It's got there are enormous challenges with doing that.
Before I was at the Department of Energy, I was at Pacific Northwest National Laboratory. It's on the edge of the Hanford site, and this is where all of the plutonium that the U.S. ever made is.
There's people
job who's currently is to trek this 100-mile triangle with a Geiger counter looking for radioactive waste and digging it up. And it's a huge issue. They have 10 times the national average of blood cancers, although there's no detectable amounts of radioactive pollution in the river. So, I mean, that's a huge issue, too. The deployment issue, I think, for nuclear power is extremely important to consider. Do you know how many nuclear power plants are currently like in either planning or processing phase in the U.S., I think it's maybe like four, one of which the most known is in outside of Savannah, and it's been going up for, I think, 20 years or something like that, and it's still under contention. So, like, aside from the fact you need to put so many down on the ground, and then the fact that it takes forever to do it, and then you don't know what to do with the waste, it's just really untenable. And
it's maybe the last thing it's a conversation worth having, but as you might imagine, the conversation has been had among a lot of people who are thinking about this. It basically really doesn't stand out from a cost standpoint. It's not even competitive cost-wise at this point, even if you get rid of the regulatory bureaucracy. So it might play a small role moving forward, but it's probably not the major thing that's going to help us get where we need to go.
Anything else? Thank you. This is, I guess, a strategy kind of question. How do we help our EPA scientists to get their work to the public, and to get to their work, and to get their work to the public? Any thoughts?
Well, I think the work that the EPA scientists and other government scientists, you know, whether it's NASA, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, Department of Energy, and a whole host of others, has been getting to the public over the last decade or so quite effectively. How do we continue to do that? The genie's out of the bottle at this point, and there are so many ways now to communicate and to disseminate information. I think one of the things that has maybe struck all of us is if you were working in climate change communication, you knew that the disinformation machinery was ginned up and working pretty well. But I don't think we understood, I certainly didn't, how well this notion of fake news across the board was ginned up and working and being propagated not through sort of the past pathways, which is sort of front groups that sometimes call themselves think tanks, and et cetera. But now, just through social media, I don't think any of us know exactly how to deal with that. But the flip side of that is, you know, as there have been some apparently gag orders being put forward by the new administration on government scientists, they have just as quickly found a way around it. And I don't think, at this point, I don't think you're going to be able to stop it. So I'm not that worried about this as a long-term problem.
I think one of the biggest issues is just funding, continued funding for research. So much research comes from federal dollars. I think there are some foundations that have the pockets, the deep pockets to help support this, but I don't think that's a tenable solution anyway. And as Rob alluded to, and I'll speak for Rob and myself, scientists are a wily bunch, and we've been fighting for logic and reason for a very long time, and we know how to do it, and we know how to make stuff, and we know how to get it out there, and we'll get around, right? So, yeah, I'm not worried about the communication, I'm just worried about getting funding, and then also just being swamped by bad communications as well. Something that we deal with on a daily basis is somebody will trust us to send somebody to the moon, to build their computer and their cell phone, to tell everybody how it works and make everything for them, but they don't trust us on this thing because reasons, right? So they trust us in all other capacities except for when it's not convenient or you can be tricked otherwise. So we battle this on a daily basis, and it's extremely frustrating, and we just keep working on it.
It's also worth pointing out, you know, Steve, you may want to say something on this too. 2/3 of the American public believes this is a problem. We're not in the minority in this room. Well, if you believe this is a problem, you are not. I apologize for making assumptions. To my mind, the challenge is not communicating what the problem is. The challenge is communicating the scale of the problem, the scale of the risk, and the scale of the opportunity and to move forward, and the work that's being done on that. And so, which is just further motivating to people who already believe we have a problem. So
part of, just to go back to my branding, so part of the path to positive we're trying to do is actually show and meet people where they are in this. It's not maybe worth your time. If there's a staunch denier, it's not worth your time. Let it go. It's going to be okay, because you're not going to flip them, you're going to waste a lot of energy, and they're not going to have as much value. It's the people, 2/3 think it's a problem, 10% are trying to do something about it, right? Everybody else is like, I got to take the kids to school. And I think it's a perfectly valid concern when you're like, I got so many other things. But what you can do is you can empower them by saying, look, why don't you turn off your lights? Why don't you like ride the bus with your kid? I mean, like, if there's very, very simple, easy ways to message to say that you can be empowered and you can be impactful, and it's not as hard as you think. And you can do it with maintaining your lifestyle in a lot of ways. And you have to meet this at various levels. So if you're a policymaker, you gotta hit them in the policy, right? So you can put policies forward. But if it's just a mom and some kids, say, you can take the bus, you can turn the lights off, you can help out, you can eat sustainably. I mean, you can empower and meet a lot of people a lot of ways and things happen.
And this is a great question, as you're stimulating lots of thought here. What Ryan put up earlier is something I tell people all the time and haven't said today. But if you can do nothing else, you can help normalize the conversation. If you can do nothing else, you can help normalize the conversation. And you don't have to pretend to be a climate scientist. And in fact, I think the single most effective thing you can say to someone is, well, I don't know all the climate science. I've seen some talks, I've been convinced, and I know that the vast majority of the world's scientists are convinced. All of the world's national academies and royal societies have issued statements on this topic to the effect of the information I gave you. Every relevant scientific organization on the planet has issued public written statements to this effect. As a citizen, that should be worth something. Expertise and knowledge should count. And if you're trying to normalize the conversation, you don't have to pretend to be able to answer every technical physics question that gets raised. You can say, well, does the Earth go through natural cycles? Yeah, I guess so. I don't know about all that. All I know is the National Academies of Science tells me this is a big problem. And so I'm going to give them the benefit of the doubt. And even if that's the only way you can normalize the conversation, I think, you know, carry your own credibility that you have built up in your communities, in your friends, into this conversation and raise it. There was a study done 18 months ago that said, Gallup did this, that climate change was the single most polarizing issue in American society, which phrased another way is, we'll sit down to Thanksgiving dinner with our challenging relatives, friends, and we will talk about marriage equality, immigration, gun rights, and abortion before we will talk about climate change. I'm not diminishing the importance of those topics, but I'm saying that we've got to normalize the conversation.
And along those lines, would you tell us about your presentations that are available online? Can we go online and find your presentations and share them maybe?
Yes, in fact, you send me an email. I just haven't got these on a convenient website yet, but there are websites. If you send me an email or reach me via Twitter, I have a video series of about 16 videos. They're about 5 minutes each that kind of takes you through the climate science that you just saw in a little bit more detail. Total 75 minutes of viewing time. There are a number of other videos. In fact, the CCL video presentation I gave in Park City a few months ago, they have that online, and I have a link to that. And there are a few other presentations I have given that are online. Sometimes people ask me for the visuals themselves. I'm happy to provide those, but I'll just say they're not really very standalone. They kind of need the words to go with them, and so it's maybe better use of your time to grab one of the videos of the presentations that are already out there and just use those. So if you send me an email, I will send you links, or if you contact CCL, they will send you links as well.
I threw this together very briefly just to kind of run down through what we have, but if you'd like to write to me and I can give you some more information on the network, it's at ryan@utahcleanenergy.org. Oh, sorry, that's it. UtahCleanEnergy.org. You can follow us on Facebook and Twitter as well. I encourage you to do that. I digest a lot of climate news, and I try to put forth non-aggressive and factual information forward, so I vet it myself. Check Facebook and Twitter often for things coming down the pipeline, international, local policy things too. So that's the best way to engage with us. Write me an email, and then we can get you more engaged in the network as appropriate for whatever you would like to contribute.
It's at Utah Climate Action, UT Climate Action, and then Climate Action Network on Facebook. You can search it, and it'll pop up.
And this specific presentation is not online, but there are some other similar ones that are. If you email me at GlazerSteve, GlazerSteve, @yahoo.com, I can direct you there. There's also quite a bit of resources with Citizens Climate Lobby at citizensclimatelobby.org.
Okay, thank you very much. This is a question, I think it pertains to one of your slides, Rob, and maybe understanding it. How come the warmer areas are at the North Pole?
Right. So you saw the much more intense warming happening in the high northern latitudes. Go through this one here.
So the very detailed physics is fairly complex, as you might imagine, but it's pretty well understood. I'll give you sort of a hand-waving answer that will hopefully make it plausible. So most of the land mass is in the northern hemisphere, and land as opposed to water warms up faster than water. For those of you technically trained, the specifics is something called specific heat. The specific heat of land and air is much less than the specific heat of water, which means if you dump a certain amount of energy into the land or into the air, it will raise the temperature more than that same amount of energy dumped into water. So the oceans are a big modifier of the climate system. The southern hemisphere has a lot more water. It just takes a longer for it to... It takes more energy to warm it up. Also, when you get cold, that air contains less moisture, and dry air, for the same reason the specific heat, warms up faster than moist air, which is also one of the reasons that we're warming up faster here in the American West, is because we have pretty dry air. So on average, you sort of warm up faster. Now, there is more detail to this. The physics of what's energy transfer is pretty complex, and it's more complicated than I just mentioned, but that's sort of the first little pass of trying to understand it.
Thank you. Here's a question. that means I have no idea what it means. Explain Palmer Drought Index.
So the slides I showed you on soil moisture, that was actually soil moisture. That wasn't Palmer Drought Index. But the Palmer Drought Index is another means of looking at soil moisture, basically. And it takes into account, and I'm not an expert on this, but to the best of my knowledge, so it certainly takes into account soil type and how much moisture it holds, along with vegetative type, and so how easy it is to extract the moisture from the soil. As you can imagine, it's harder to extract it from soil that's got a vegetative cover than soil that doesn't. And if there's anyone in the room that knows more about the PDI, Palmer Drought Index, please feel free to add to that. But it's just another way of it's another metric that's useful for looking at soil moisture. Yeah.
And another rather technical question, explain feedback loops using permafrost as an example.
So the way we understand how the Earth changes temperature,
is basically with a trigger and a feedback. So something gets the ball rolling. So think of the ice ages. You drop down from an interglacial period like we're in now, 10 or 12 degrees Fahrenheit global average, into an ice age, and you stay there for 100,000 years, and then something changes and you pop back up 10 or 15 degrees Fahrenheit for another 20,000 years. So something got the change rolling. And that we understand in this particular, in the case of the ice ages, what gets the change rolling are small changes in solar energy over many thousands of years. It has to do with Earth's orbital parameters and the tilt of its axis. They're called Milankovitch cycles for anyone who knows a little bit about it. But the point is that the change in solar energy gets things moving, either cooling off or warming up. But when you do the physics, the change in the solar energy isn't enough to cause the size of temperature change that you see. So other things are involved, and these are feedbacks. And feedbacks can be positive or negative. A positive feedback is something that amplifies the initial change. And a negative feedback is something that tamps down the initial change, tends to be stabilizing. And it turns out the climate system is filled with some amplifying feedbacks. One of them, using permafrost, is that sequestered in permafrost. So permafrost is permanently frozen soil. And sequestered in that permanently frozen soil is methane, which is another powerful greenhouse gas. So as you warm up the permafrost and it thaws, the methane gets released from the soil and goes into the atmosphere, causing the planet to warm more, which causes more of the permafrost to melt, which causes more methane to go into the atmosphere, which causes more warming. And that notion of a feedback also works with the oceans. Oceans sequester carbon dioxide. As you warm them up, carbon dioxide comes out of the ocean, goes into the atmosphere, exactly the same way your soda goes flat when it gets warm, which causes more warming, which causes more release. And it also melts the ice caps. And the ice caps are big reflectors of solar energy. They're white. So the sun hits the ice cap and it goes right back into space. But when you melt the ice cap, the surface is replaced by either water or rock underneath, and those are really good absorbers of sunlight. And so there's another feedback. You melt more ice, which exposes more rock, which absorbs more water, which absorbs more solar energy, which warms things up, which releases more methane, which releases more carbon dioxide, which melts more ice, which causes... So you get this amplifying feedback going in. And that's how we understand big changes in climate in the Earth system.
Thank you. And that made sense. This question has to do with the carbon fees and dividends. Looking toward larger families, do they get more dividends than smaller families? How would that work?
The way that we've structured the dividend is that every adult gets the same amount back. The first two children get a half share. So if you were to say, let's say there were
$100 to distribute. Obviously, there's a lot more. And if there were, we'll say, 10 adults, to make it simple, we'll just say it's five families of two adults each, and then we'll throw in 20 children of various numbers. So the we have 10 adults, so that's 10 shares to be distributed. Those 20 children, if it was two per family, you would have 10 more shares because each of those would be half a share. But if instead we had, you know, four children in one family and one in another and so forth, and you say the number of children where there's no more than two in the family works out to be 12 kids, then you have 16 shares total, and that would divide that up. So let me say, that was probably a little bit muddled. The simple way of putting it is that we would account for the first two children, but your energy use, you know, each additional person in the family doesn't scale up the energy used equally, and so beyond two is where we have it capped off in our proposal.
This is a historical question. Were there inversions, that is, of course, keeping cold air close to the ground because of the hot air above, before the Salt Lake Valley was settled?
Yes.
And throughout the settlement.
Yeah, it's a geological process, right? So it's just cold air trapped below warmer air. Right? So if you have a geological feature, inversions happen in a lot of places. So if you look, so we have really poor air quality here, obviously. If you look at other places in the U.S., you'll see other places with really poor air quality. It's because they have very similar geographies. So there are geographies that are prone to getting inversions.
What I would say is that the inversion is a weather phenomenon. We're the ones that add the pollution to it.
All right, if there are no more questions that haven't been collected, any other questions on there? Okay, I think thank you very much to our panel. This has been extremely informative. One of the things that I thought about as you were talking was that in conversations with friends in the last 2 weeks, I have heard so much about what can we do next, what can we do to take action about the issues that concern us. And I want to talk about the unit meetings at the end of the month again. That's exactly what these unit meetings are directed at, what we can do, how we can take action on this particular issue. So keep that in mind, and thank you so much for being here. We appreciate your attendance.